Very good afternoon. We have with us Dr. Ashna Sood. She is an economist by the education, and she is the she works for the urban development as her profession. So we see how much has she sacrificed looking at the social problem. I mean, I see an economist passed out from Cornell University, Upla, like, oh my God. But look at the work, look at the pain which she is looking in the society and working to advance it. And this is a very genuine comment, I'm not making it up. Yeah. So, ma'am, so before we can proceed with the question, it would be really helpful for us if you could insight into what exactly you do.
Sudeep, thank you for that introduction, but I should tell you that what I don't do because it's painful, I do it because it's fun. And my work is really at the intersection of institutional economics and urban development. And I've been particularly interested in the ways in which new policy models are emerging to encourage, on the one hand, privatized provision of basic services, privatized planning, as well as privatized governance, forms of governance. So I have looked at, models such as the special economic zones, there are also national investment and manufacturing zones that are coming up. Here in Hyderabad, in the states, different states, in many different states, in Hyderabad there is an instrument called the Industrial Area Local Authority, which I've looked at in a lot of detail. So I bring very much sort of the interest and the frameworks from economics, in particular public economics, but I'm also interested in using a wide variety of tools from many different disciplines. So in a way, my work is far more interdisciplinary now than it was, when I trained as an economist. So that's really sort of the set of questions that I look at in a lot of detail.
Painfulness is the pain that you see in the urban displacement, how you made it as a fun to work on it. I have often been misunderstood. So, yeah. So, ma'am, but I was waiting. So, moving on to the next question, which is how feasible it is for the state to provide for housing for all? Is it really practically possible?
No, I think that's sort of a very, very interesting question. And here's the thing, right? Public provided housing is certainly the norm in many different countries around the world. In India, actually, it has not succeeded. And in fact, if you look at models of housing provision in India, and this goes all the way from slums to unauthorized housing in Delhi, there are new forms called Akrama Sakrama in Karnataka, Kuntiwari in Maharashtra. All of these are coming up with what might be called private enterprise, right? This is not large-scale capital. This is really sort of the petty bourgeoisie. These are sort of the small-scale micro entrepreneurs who are building their housing as they go along. And certainly the thinking, and I think sort of the most pioneering planners are increasingly beginning to realize that this is really the most sustainable forms of housing provision, that you encourage people to build as they can and slowly grow on what they have built, right? And this is a model that I've seen up close in parts of Delhi where I come from. And you see that people start in a very small way, but over a period of time they're able to build up both in terms of their livelihoods, they're able to do better, and they're able to invest more in their housing. So the question then is, how does the state support these processes rather than making them illegal? And the tragedy is that a lot of this, in most Indian cities, anywhere from half to two-thirds or more of housing provision is through these informal kind of approaches.
So ma'am, can we say, a very good comment on it, can we say like the state owns the land? It has all the power to make it legal, illegal. I mean, it's ultimately up to the state to declare it is illegal or as whether it's legal or illegal. Suppose few people build up their own house in a trust, in a government land. So government anyway is like, I think they have reduced the burden of the government to construct a house. So do you see that there's an opportunity for the state, like if there's a regulation and if more and more of these societies are like legalized, then it will work towards providing housing for
No, absolutely, you are quite correct. I think sort of there are a number of issues that come out from what you're saying. We had, you know, Justice Muralidhar who led the session on the right to housing, the concurrent session of which I was part. And, you know, there was also Dr. Indu Prakash Singh, and they said some very interesting things, right? So one of the things that Professor Muralidhar told us was that the master plan is in fact a legal instrument. And that is in fact what creates legality and illegality. And there is a lot of work, for instance, Dr. Gautam Bhan, who was to be part of the session, was not able to attend. He's really mapped the way in which, you know, various kinds of informalities and illegalities, that whole spectrum, and the ways in which there is squatting, for instance, in bastis where people don't buy the land, versus unauthorized colonies where people have bought the land, but in various ways the state does not recognize that entitlement, right? The problem really in India has been that the master plan has become an instrument to reduce illegality. And that is also because the master plan in the Indian context is so focused on physical planning that it doesn't recognize the idea of mixed use, which is that often people want to live very close to where they're working. So you have separate zones, say, for industrial activity or for commercial areas or for residential areas, and not recognizing that people who own shops in an area also want to live close to that. So the master plan, to the extent that it does not acknowledge the way that people live in Indian cities, it creates illegalities, and that's the big barrier.
So the capital capitalists, they enter the legal way and they spread the illegality. So in a technical or colonial way, they enter into the illegal way and they can never do the illegal thing. That's what people perceive. Anyway, so just next. So do you think this connection between slums and crimes is overrated?
Oh yes, absolutely, absolutely. And you know, there are different ways to sort of address that problem. In the Indian context, quite honestly, I have not seen the data looking at, you know, crime in slums versus non-slums. But there is actually, you know, we have a way to like look at the sort of question of crime from a very different perspective. So I think one of the most insightful urban planners was somebody who was never trained in urban planning. Her name was Jane Jacobs. And she, you know, wrote this book called The Death and Life of Great American Cities in the 1960s. She was an activist and she was a very, very profoundly original urban thinker. She talked about the idea of eyes on the street. So she says that in areas which are mixed use, where there are shops and there are houses, basically people are watching out for each other, right? Strangers are watching out for each other. If there are children playing on the street, you know, neighbors will say, oh, kid, don't do this, right? Or here's somebody who looks dangerous, right? This is the notion of eyes on the street. And if you go to any Indian basti or slum, in many ways those forces, you know, are in play. You see people, these are tight-knit communities, but there is also people coming in as migrants, and they, you know, because they're in that area, they know each other, and they're providing these services, they're providing those eyes on the street. In contrast, and I can really vouch for this, in areas which are master planned and developed, for instance, you know, in Delhi, I know the DDA localities. In those areas, because you know they want to put up walls and gates, and crime levels actually, and particularly, you know, property crimes, you know, theft and so on, are very, very high. Right? So I don't think the relationship has been investigated empirically, but certainly there's a lot to tell us that in fact it might be the other way around, that slums are in fact safer than other parts of the Indian city.
So maybe the few of the best example of criticism was the inductive method.
Well, I think so. I certainly believe in
that. So now moving on, like we talk about development of the people. This is what the state is meant for, like providing liberty, security, liberty, life and property. So none of this will take place if there is no house. Shouldn't it be a fundamental right, not emerging from Article 21, but made a particular fundamental right, like 21A, who is codified right to education. The first thing I need to see is the idea of have a roof over my head.
Absolutely.
So this is the first fundamental right in the Constitution.
Absolutely. I think for me, certainly in this concurrent session on right to housing, where you know I was part of the panel, this was sort of really the underlying, very interesting debate that was going on between those, and that includes, you know, sort of Anandita, who wrote the study, Dr. Adan Mariganti, a few of them who were saying that you don't need a necessarily a legal right to housing, instead it can be negotiated at the local level. A few others, I will count myself among them, but also I think Justice Muralidhar was saying that you need right to legal right to housing. And for me, certainly the question is, how would a master plan look like if there is a right to housing, where you say that people should have the right to obtain, build their own housing, have some kind of claims on the housing that they build, where close to their livelihoods, place of livelihoods, right? So I think if we can actually codify and give a legal shape to a right to housing, I think it would change tremendously and for the better the way that Indian cities look. And just to finally, I think, wrap up, for me, the evidence from this case of South Africa, and you know, there was an academic there who spoke about the South African case, was incredible, because he said that now, compared to India, in South Africa, anytime there is an eviction, the court gets involved and the government has to answer many, many questions before it can decide to displace people from their communities, from their land, from their houses where they have lived for some period of time.
Yes. So, sometimes anyway, if people do not have house, they do not have this fundamental, but it certainly gives the rich people something to play with, drive them, kill them, nobody cares. Do you think that migration needs to be addressed? Migration of workers is a problem. Like, they, I'm not saying that because they are coming and populating the cities, that's why they need to be reduced. But do you think that the agriculture facility should be provided? I was interacting with one of the workers, he migrated to Pune from Chhattisgarh. The reason is that they cannot grow the wheat. So at the time of wheat, which is a bit, which starts from like winter, so they migrate to go and work.
No, absolutely. I think such an important question. In my own work, previous work, I have looked at the role of migrants in the cycle rickshaw sector in the last four Chhattisgarh. And I found it is incredible, because the cycle rickshaw sector depends a lot on the labor of migrants. And these are, exactly as you're saying, they are seasonal migrants. They are temporary migrants who are coming from their villages, in sort of the agricultural lean season, right? I think, so China has tried to restrict migration, and they've developed a very complicated system of, regulating migration as much as possible. I think that in a free country, there's no scope for that. And in fact, migrants provide, array of really central services in Indian cities. If you look at, all of these high rises in Indian cities, who is building them? These are migrant construction workers, right? So I think the city needs to welcome and make place for migrants, even if they're coming for short periods of time, instead of trying to stop those migration waves. And there's, of course, a large literature around this, there has been some discussion of exclusionary urbanization. People based out of Calcutta, they have done a lot of interesting work around the ways in which migrants come into the city and face all kinds of exclusions. And we need to, I think, from a policy perspective, policymakers should ask, how can we make cities more welcoming to migrants, rather than, putting up a sort of a stop sign, right, and saying no entry.
Not even indirectly producing agriculture. I can correlate this question with these small scale industries that are talking about development of agriculture sector to stop the migration. So do you think these small scale industries too have been ignored, neglected, dying by the isolation?
I certainly think so. My own interest, I have looked, I think as anybody who looks at the Indian city in any kind of detail, right, and you try to study it, you see how important is that micro-enterprise to keeping the city running, right? And I certainly think that in a lot of ways, and this we see also with the demonetization policy experiment, that to some extent it was not recognized the very important role, the sort of key nodal points where all kinds of small-scale industry, micro-enterprises are keeping things going, right? They might be providing informal transport services, but they are central nodes through which a lot of our economic flows go. There's a lot of policy talk all the time, how to encourage SMEs, right? Small and medium enterprises. But there's definitely a huge blind spot there, because, actually in India, if you look at the distribution, statistical distribution of enterprises, many of them are very, very, very small, right? And that relates also to the fact that these workers cannot afford to live in high rises. They live in slums, right? They live in busties. So if you look at the economy of a place like Dharavi, it is based precisely on that intersection of people doing informal work and living in informal kind of housing. So absolutely, I think that Indian, and I think we need research there. We need, policy makers to say what data can we find? What do we know about these micro enterprises, these small scale industries, and how can we then help them?
Last question related to Islam. How difficult it is, you think, for a student who's living in Islam to make it into a good university within the country, outside the country, giving the kind of competitive exams with me. So how, what do we, I mean, what is it, what he can do? Should he stop dreaming about prestigious universities?
No, absolutely not. I think any society that is successful and that can be judged as successful has to provide mobility, right? Mm-hmm. And that is economic mobility across generations. Around the world, unfortunately, there is a lot of evidence that mobility is slowing down. So we had a period where, it was very easy for the son of somebody, say, who worked in a small shop to go and do big things, right? And this was certainly the case in most of Western Europe, North America. Now that economic mobility is slowing down, but that said, I think in India, because we do have pretty vibrant economic growth, even though it is Now, most recent studies are saying it's very unequally distributed. The gains from growth are going to only a small sector. But yes, I think there are, to the extent that you have meritocratic institutions, absolutely, I think there is scope for dreams and realizing those dreams. But that said, I think a big challenge we have faced is this focus on, small institutes of excellence and neglect of the larger ecosystem of education, right? And one hopes that, certainly this is an experiment ongoing in Delhi where they're investing in a very big way in very high quality public education, government school education, right? And I think that's really the model to go forward and also to consolidate these gains from economic growth.
So, this is not a question, this is a platform for you to tell what sort of work we miss, which you have been doing, what do you think the major concerns we have, which has not gained the introduction, or which hasn't received the concern of the policy makers?
Oh yes, absolutely. So since I'm very glad that I have this opportunity to, talk with you about some of these, I think, really important issues that affect, the way that we live in our cities. For me, really, a trend that I see, I think, becoming even more salient, getting accentuated, is, economic dualism within Indian cities. So, on the one hand, you have the slum, on the other hand, you have the high-rise, and there is some relationship between them, but the policy attention is really on, attracting private investment flows into housing, right? The unfortunate thing that is not getting recognized is that those private investment flows cannot provide certain kinds of housing at all, right? So who will cater to the security guards, to the domestic workers, to the small shop owners, right? How are we going to be able to meet the needs of what I call a shadow economy? And those shadow settlements that are emerging alongside these hubs, whether they be special economic zones, whether they be the new, cities, and certainly we've heard in Gujarat, there's Thoril Tholera, there's Gift City, in Andhra Pradesh, they're talking about Amravati. But the question is, you can make large investments in building, beautiful cities, but they will always be a shallow settlement. And how do you make sure that you accommodate that shallow settlement and make it as thriving, as productive, as rich as what you have invested in?
This one question, I'm not asking it, somebody else is asking me to ask it. The entire world, you're working on special economic zones, right? Development of special economics. So the people who are working at SEZ, are they conscious about this climate change and green tree? And they're cutting, I've come across so many trees were to be cut to develop airport and some other, construction of special economic zones requires a lot of environment to be damaged.
in a way, certainly I know that the Telangana State Industrial Infrastructure Corporation, which builds a lot of industrial estates and also SEZs around Hyderabad and Telangana more broadly, they are investing and thinking a lot about issues of, basically saving and conserving resources, right? I think for me, it's not simply a matter of, of course, climate change will require us to do things very differently, but I think there are still issues of equity, right? Equality in terms of, one, the outcomes from climate change, and also the way that we distribute resources, not just how we use them, but also how we distribute access to those resources. Right, and to some extent, I think that's sort of really the concern with the special economic zones. Even if it is possible to make, implement certain schemes which are in some ways more enlightened than elsewhere, but I still think that this, you have to think about the larger repercussions and the side effects as much as anything else.
We are extremely organized for Dr. Ashima Sood for her precious time. We wish her good luck, and I hope her dream materializes and every individual in the country has a house over this.